Good morning, everybody. Happy 4th of July weekend. So glad you joined us here today. Welcome to Venture Church. Would you stand on your feet? We're going to get ready to worship the name of Jesus. Jamie's going to lead us in this song. Come on, let's sing it out together.
Lying.
place in you. We believe that you are our hope, our peace, Father. We place everything that we have before you, God. Bless us. We pray for our city, for our communities, Lord. For salvation, for transformation, in Jesus' name.
Greater things have yet to come. Greater things. Oh, July 4th, 1776, our founding fathers signed the Declaration of Independence. We know this day as the very first Independence Day. It is now an American holiday associated with food, fun, family, and fireworks. Lots of fireworks. It's a day when we celebrate what's important. It's a day when we celebrate this nation's freedom. It is also a chance for us to focus on another freedom that we have, a freedom given to us not by our founding fathers, but by our Heavenly Father. So as we take time to celebrate our nation's independence and freedom, let's also pause and thank God for our spiritual freedom from sin, shame, and fear. A freedom that has been made possible by Jesus.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Happy 4th of July. So glad that you've chosen to join us this morning on Facebook Live or on YouTube. Unfortunately, we weren't able to be in our regular location today because of the holiday, so we're back to an online service, but we're glad that you've chosen to join us today. As we get started this morning, let me give you just a few announcements. First is the fact that we have a beach night this Friday night, July 9th at Loudermilk Park. It's a prayer night, and we're going to get together as families. It'll be a lot of fun, but it'll be a time when we spend some time in prayer. And we just encourage you to come out with your family, and there'll be some fun activities that our youth and children team have put together for the kids. But the kids will stay with you. It'll be a family night. If you want to bring food, feel free to bring any food that you may want. But it's just going to be a time where you get together, and at one point, we're going to stop, and we're going to spend some time together in prayer. Also, as you probably are well aware of by now, there is some activity brewing out in the Caribbean and heading towards the Gulf area. As this happens, we just need to make sure that we're prepared. After we've taken care of our own things, and if a storm comes this way and does affect our area, whether it's this one or one in the future, we do have a hurricane response team that we'll get together. We'll go out, hand out water, clean up, do some light work to help out folks, just to be the hands and feet of Jesus in the community. If that's something that you'd like to be a part of, we would love to have you join us. We do all of our coordination right through Facebook Live, and so that's how you'll see where we're at, where we're meeting, what we're doing. So after a storm, if you've got power and the ability, all the coordination will happen through our Facebook page, so look for it there. All right, last week, Pastor Roger gave us a challenge, the Philippian challenge, just encouraging folks to get involved in reading the Word of God. And I hope that you took advantage of that this week. Reading, studying, and memorizing God's Word is an essential element of spiritual growth. It's how we know God. It's how we grow in our relationship to God. God reveals Himself to us through His Word. A healthy spiritual life is built upon truth. But sadly today, truth is under attack in our country. Things that many of us have long held to be common knowledge are now up for debate. Something as simple as determining one's own gender has been thrown into question. By embracing moral relativism or even political correctness, many people in our country now believe that what's true for you may not be true for me, and what's true for this person may not be true for that person, or what's true in this situation may not be true in another situation. And at the end of the day, truth has become situational. Truth depends upon the circumstances. Let me ask you, does that sound right to you? Does that make sense to you? Well, today we want to talk about truth. And so just before we get started, let's join together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come before You this morning, and I do pray that as we spend these moments in Your Word, God, that You would speak to us, that You would speak through me the message You'd have for this hour, and God, that You would show us just how very important Your truth is. Lord, we just dedicate this time to You in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, when the foundations of truth are undermined, lies and false narratives run rampant, and bad things start to happen. The foundation of any relationship is based on truth and honesty and trust. And when that truth is violated, when that truth is twisted, the relationship begins to erode, and eventually it can lead to collapse. And the same thing is true in a country. When a country abandons truth and removes all absolutes, rights and wrongs become subjective. And before long, we're no different than the society that existed before the days of Noah, when every man did that which was right in his own eyes. So that's why it's so important for God's people to read God's Word, to know God's Word, to study God's Word, to memorize God's Word, because it is the foundation of our beliefs. It's the foundation of truth. God's Word is the guide that leads us through life. You know, David said in Psalm 73, verse 23, "Yet I am always with you. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterward you will take me to glory." God says that in His Word that you guide me. God guides us with His counsel. In the Old Testament times, God's guidance was external. When God wanted to move the children of Israel, there would be a cloud that would appear above the tabernacle. And when the cloud stayed steady, the people stayed. And when the cloud moved, the people moved. And that was how God guided and directed people. But in the New Testament, things change. God's guidance is not so much outward as it is inward. We see in John chapter 16, verse 13, it says, "But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak of His own. He will speak only what He hears, and He will tell you what is yet to come." He says here that God's Spirit, His indwelling presence within us, will guide us into all truth. And this is the truth that we need today. More than ever before, we need to take a stand for the truth. As I said at the beginning, truth is under attack in our country, and we as followers of Jesus Christ, we as the church, must take a stand for the truth. French philosopher and theologian Blaise Pascal said this, "Without truth as an underpinning, and when Christianity is diminished in society, there is room for inequality, slavery, eugenics, dehumanization, and moral relativism." And we see this happening today as the foundations of truth begin to erode. We see these things happening. Someone asked John MacArthur to define truth, and I like the way he defined it. He says, "Truth is that which is consistent with the mind, will, character, glory, and being of God." Essentially, truth comes from God. And he shows us, God is the foundation of all truth. And that really makes sense, because He's the one who created everything. He's the lawgiver. He's the one who established everything. So it makes sense that he would be the one who establishes truth. Psalm 119, verse 159 says, "See how I love your precepts. Preserve my life, Lord, in accordance with your love." Listen to this in verse 160. "All your words are true. All your righteous laws are eternal." And then we see in the New Testament that God established that all His teachings are true when He said this. Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth. And the truth will" what? "Set you free." It's when we know the truth that the truth will set us free. And my friends, in a day when truth is under attack, we must be men and women of the truth. We must stand for that which is true, even if it's not popular in our society, even if it's not socially acceptable. The day is coming when those who stand for the truth will probably be labeled as a hate group for not accepting everyone's opinions as equally valid. If you can't see that day coming, I encourage you to take your head out of the sand, because that day is coming. I believe that we are living in the perilous times that the Apostle Paul wrote about in his letter to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3. Have you ever considered what the end game is? Have you ever considered what happens when a country abandons the truth? When a country just disconnects from that which is true? Well, the Apostle Paul was clear on what happens when that happens, and it's found in Romans chapter 1. And I just want to read this passage to you, because it's so very telling of what happens when we disconnect from the truth. Romans 1, verse 21. "For although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God or gave thanks to Him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts to sexual impurity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Verse 26, because of this, God gave them over to shameful lusts. Even their women exchanged natural sexual relations for unnatural ones. In the same way, the men also abandoned natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their error. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a depraved mind so that they do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They're full of envy and murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They're gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They have no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these things, but also approve of those who practice them. My friends, this is a haunting foreshadow of our future if we do not repent and turn back to the truth. And unfortunately, we see this playing out before our very eyes. Hatred fills our streets. Murder is on the rise. Evil has become normalized in our society. What can we do? I don't want to spend all of our time today talking about how bad things have become or can become. Instead, I want us to embrace the reality that as the church, we must assume responsibility to know the truth, to live the truth, to carry the truth, to share the truth, to hear the truth, to accept the truth. My friends, it is our responsibility to stand for the truth in these difficult days. Oh, I know it's easier to just go along to get along, to stay quiet and to not raise a fuss, but it's our duty as followers of Christ to share the truth with every man, woman, and child in this country. God's truth is not given to steal our joy and to keep us from enjoying life. It's given to protect us from the things that will steal our joy and destroy us. Back to Psalm 119, David writes in verse 9, how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. You know, throughout Scripture, we see these warnings. You know, we're aware of signs and alarms and fences and barricades and ropes and caution tapes and locks and all of these things that were created for the purpose of keeping people out of places they shouldn't be. We put fences around swimming pools to keep kids from getting into the pools. Anything that's deadly, anything that's dangerous, there's usually some kind of a warning to, hey, you need to stay away from that. And God does the same thing in His Word. He gives us warnings. He puts up fences and barricades and tells us that we need to be careful and stay away from these things because they're harmful to us. They're harmful to others. The Bible is full of warnings and commandments that are designed to keep us from getting hurt. We get ourselves into a heap of trouble when we ignore God's teachings in the Bible and we wander away from the straight and narrow paths that are laid out in His Word. If you notice, there's a fence here behind me today. A fence has two purposes. A fence can serve to keep someone in, to corral them, to not let them roam free. The fence behind me was created to keep horses in a pasture, to keep them from just being able to run free throughout the community and around the neighborhood. But there's a second purpose for a fence, and that's to keep those inside this fence free from whoever may be on the outside trying to get in. Just to my left, I'm looking at our chicken coop. Our chicken coop was built very strong, and we put up this hardware cloth to keep other creatures that would love to eat our chickens from being able to get in to the hen house. So two fences, two purposes. A fence basically establishes a safe boundary. It's like the railing on a balcony. Unfortunately, many people view God's commandments in the Bible like the first fence. They see God's law and God's rules as being restrictive and unfair because they don't allow us to run free and just do whatever we may want to do. They may say things like, the Bible is just a book of rules designed to keep people from having fun. Therefore, they reject God's word only later to realize the consequences of abandoning the truth. Instead, we need to see God's word like the second fence that's there to protect us, that's designed to keep the bad from getting into us, to keep the evil from influencing us. God's word offers us safety and protection from the evil that exists in the world. My friends, the reality is Satan wants to destroy your life. He wants to destroy my life. He wants to destroy this country. Sin entices us to do things that will ultimately destroy our life, our family, and our relationships, and our reputation. And God wants to spare you, and He wants to spare me of the pain of this sinful behavior. So He gives us instructions in His Word on what to do and what not to do. Again, David the psalmist said in Psalm 119, verse 9, "Oh, let me not wander from Your commandments." That should be our cry every morning. Lord, let me not wander from Your commandments. Don't let me wander back to my sinful past. Don't let me wander back to the ways I used to be. Help me to stay pure. What did the text say a young man should do to stay pure? Verse 11, take heed according to Your word. You see, my friends, God's word is a guide that tells us, hey, don't go there. Avoid that place. You shouldn't be there. And these truths are for our benefits. It's not to steal our joy. It's to keep us safe. It's to keep us from making terrible decisions. And the reality is life is meant to be enjoyed in the parameters that God has given us. God wants us to have joy. He tells us to rejoice. We should enjoy life. But we enjoy life best when we do it within the parameters that God has established in His Word. The challenge for you and I today is to both know and to seek the truth. And I truly believe that God's Word is true. Therefore, we should let it guide our lives. Let it guide our decisions. Let it inform us of the things that we should do. Let it protect us from the evil that exists in the world. My friends, we need to embrace the truth today. Today is July 4th, Independence Day, America's birthday, a day we've set aside to celebrate freedom. And as Americans, we love our freedoms. We love to be able to speak our minds and worship in any way that we want to. We love the freedoms that we have. And tonight across this land, there are going to be fireworks displays. They're going to light up the night sky, and we're going to celebrate the birthday of this great nation. And I do hope that you will celebrate. I do hope that you will demonstrate a patriotic spirit. I hope that you do love this country. Even with all our faults, we do have a strong foundation on which to build. Together, I believe that we can work towards overcoming our differences. I believe that, as the Apostle Paul said, we should make every effort to live peaceably with all men, and that we should carry the truth from sea to shining sea. You know, the words of the Battle Hymn of the Republic are a stirring reminder of what we've discussed here this morning. And my favorite verse of this hymn says, "In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in His bosom that transfigures you and me." I love this line, "As He died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. His truth is marching on." My friends, we are the church. We are the ones entrusted with the responsibility to take the truth to every man, woman, and child in this country and around this world. That's our job. His truth is marching on. His truth is found in His Word. So my friends, let's work together to take the truth of God's Word, to take God's values, His morals, His truth out to every man, woman, and child, so that men may know what it truly means to be free. Not just free from oppression, but free from the power of sin in our lives. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, We come before you this morning and we recognize that you are the author of all that is true. And we recognize your word as the truth. So God, I pray that it would guide our life, it would inform our decisions. God, it would form the basis of our beliefs. God, that you would help us as your church to take this truth into our community, into our country. Lord, that through missions we would share this truth around the world, that people would know who you are, that you are the creator of all things, that you are the lawgiver, and not only that, that God, you are the redeemer, that Jesus Christ came to deliver us from evil, that we could be restored, that we could be reconciled to you through trust and through faith in the work of Jesus Christ. So Lord, I pray that each person that's here joining us today would understand how important it is to read, study, memorize, and know the truth, and then to let it guide our lives. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for freedom. Thank you for this day we can celebrate that freedom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, folks. Have a happy 4th of July.
Again, Lord, would you hear our cry?
a wonderful weekend.